like Mind Sky, The Diary of a Progressive Rock Musician, chapters 7 and 8. We couldn't, of course, smoke marijuana in the ballroom, so we went outside. Fragrant sea breeze and refreshing night crisp air, and her eyes were blue, and it was a quiet spot behind the ballroom where only a few other people, two couples, chatted. There was an alley behind, a closed gate, and some apartment buildings, offices, and shops, but it was a sleepy district, and no one was even scooting around on a motorbike. Busier streets were on the other side of the building, so it formed a sound barrier. I know you really see something. I mean, you're really looking and looking out outside of yourself. I mean, you see visions, and I think you're just a wonderful man, she declared after a puff of a joint. I was feeling fine off the weed buzz, and I'd relaxed from a post-performance adrenaline, and the power was subdued and rechanneled into a love high. I kissed her. It was the only thing to do, and her gooey, mint-flavored lips and tongue invigorated the salty air as the ocean of wind beat a swath down the alley. Grabbing her hips, I pulled her towards me, crushed pelvis to pelvis as we swayed to imagine music. Her paradigm of me, mine of her, yes, we were dancing sensually, cosmically, something beyond romanticism and physical passion. Time, we've got our last set to do, Mike called from the ballroom. Okay, coming just a minute, I replied. I left the girl. She'd given me her phone number and told her, and she told me to meet her the next Wednesday at Robin's Tea Room. We started out with the jazz version of a Bach standard. Mike shone on the flute. Behind everything was the beautiful melody on the Hammond organ. I finger-picked my way through the tune and then did my solo break with the wah-wah pedal. It was a real rave freak-out. The audience enjoyed it. We were bewildered and kept dancing. Another record scout afterwards. This one from Willow Tree Music. They wanted us to record an audition demo. They provided studio musicians and a full day with the engineers. If the director approved, we might be the supporting act for one of the most popular bands in Britain. I met Victoria at the Tea Room the next week. She was done up like a 19th century woman in a 19th century parlor, or was I hallucinating? This place was replete with paintings and photos of various British dignitaries, frilly lace tablecloths, settees, and other antique furniture. It was a quaint place divided into three rooms with intimate corners, ornate lamps, bookshelves of leather-bound tomes. Radios set throughout were set to a classical music station. She was a stunning girl who possessed the trepidation of the naive, yet the arching brow of the wise. Throughout the conversation, I got the feeling that she was headed into the realm of intellectual discussion, as she demonstrated the well-read foundation of a thinker. Not in the highest sophistication, but for a young woman, something more than a headspace of gossipy pop star and fashion magazines. Flashing her probing eyes, she asked me what I expected from my career. I said I'd be happy just if our band could record a hit single, even simply to be on the charts for a few weeks. Beyond that, I didn't know, yet there was always the possibility we could succeed enough to do American tours. If we could just further develop our originals instead of just doing R&B and other pop cover tunes. I know you can do it, she encouraged, grasping my hand for a moment and smiling. All in all, she didn't appear like an amateur groupie that just wanted to shag. One could say she was more virtuous, not to say that casual sex was exactly frowned upon in that current climate, only that one was discreet to some extent, and it was all done less in a spirit of rebellion and more like a philosophical statement, a good-natured social activity. We spent almost 2 hours there in the tea salon. Time flew, and it was a good atmosphere as mutual warmth increased. After inquiring if I'd be interested in seeing her record collection and the private avant-garde painting she was working on, we paid the bill and got up and left. It was only a short bus trip to her place. She shared a flat with her sister, who was up in London for a week, so she was on her own. It was a top-floor apartment with a large sitting room, one bedroom, and a small kitchen overlooking the rooftops of a dark brick terrace house towards a horizon of green countryside. Outside was dripping wet from a recent rain as the sun burst through torn clouds. The windows were clean and the white painted fence shone. A fireplace had logs ready to be lit. This was definitely an expensive dwelling in a nice neighborhood inhabited by professionals, lawyers, doctors, academics. Not the typical place for a girl her age. Glass of wine? Sure, I happily accepted. She reached in the cupboard for a bottle of French premium wine. She pronounced the brand and name in French. French and told me it was a top-rated, award-winning vintage. Wow, this is quite a well-to-do girl, I thought. She served some mozzarella and cheddar with a leftover baguette, and she'd had baked herself, and then she freshened up the pan with butter, and she toasted and roasted the bread. Then she opened a can of Spanish olives, a tin of capers, and sliced some cherry tomatoes. Yeah, and this was a good combo of warm fried bread, tangy cheese, and dry Sauvignon Blanc, and the crunchy baguette and fermented grape vapors. The aroma of cheese combined in my palate and in my nostrils, her voice tingling my ears. All the while, a flirtatious conversation on nudism at the Isle of Wight, sensual massage techniques, and body Shakespearean quotes. At the other side of the room, nestled in front of a large window which overlooked the narrow road and adjacent townhouses, was a small Irish setter puppy who was amazingly silent the whole time except for a few barks, greeting me when I first arrived. She got up from the table and put on an album of classical guitar. It was Julian Bream. Wonderfully precise, playing. I was humbled, being essentially just a folk and rock guitarist. "That's nice," I commented. "Oh yes, it's his first record. My parents gave it to me," she said. I asked her what her parents did. She related that they were linked to royalty here and centuries ago, the Netherlands. They had many properties, some publishing houses, and spent their time there also working at government functions. Of course, she had some weed, so we smoked that, and then the dog turned pink with flashing silver balls around, and Victoria was dancing in front of the fireplace as purple flakes of snow collided with moon-like orbs. Oh yeah, something was in that marijuana other than THC. "Oh, I think Jeff gave me one of the laced ones. Dipped it in LSD," she realized. Jeff was the guy that supplied her with drugs, and sometimes he wasn't careful about indicating which was which, what was what, and how it'd affect everyone. "Oh well, then I guess we're in for quite a ride," I said, laughing. Sorrow increased, or was that happiness before, but it was augmented by a visualization of Victoria being crucified in front of the window, and I wondered whether the neighbors could see or not. I was trying to figure out what would happen in that scene of cavalry, the girl nailed to a cross. Then I realized that it was just part of me mentally hallucinating. Imagining what I was thinking was part of manifested internal reality, and it was for a while, and that was why I could have been, it could have